Hi, and welcome to Enchantment of Eternity's review for A Taste of Armageddon, which is episode 23 of season 1 of Star Trek the Original Series. This video is a part of Star Trek Week here on Enchantment of Eternity, where I'm reviewing 5 episodes of Star Trek, one from each of the 5 Star Trek series. Typically, when I do a Star Trek episode review, they are requested by my viewers. However, for Star Trek Week, I'm choosing the episodes myself, episodes I personally want to review. For the original series, I chose the episode A Taste of Armageddon. Those who have seen my top 10 original series episodes video will know this episode was number 3 in my top 10. A Taste of Armageddon is the episode in which the Enterprise is sent to escort Ambassador Fox on a diplomatic mission to Aminar 7, a planet at war with another planet in the same solar system. They receive a message to avoid the planet as it's currently too dangerous to visit. However, Ambassador Fox orders them to go anyway. When they arrive, they find no signs that there is a war going on at all. Kirk and his landing party are perplexed when the Aminars act like they're being attacked, but no such attack seems to be taking place. So they discover there's fighting a war with a computer program, and when a hit is officially registered in this computer program, those in the target area must report to a disintegration chamber in order to be killed. And that way they experience none of the horrors of war. Their culture survives, but the people still die. The Enterprise is declared destroyed by the war program, so the Chancellor of Aminar 7 imprisons the landing party and attempts to trick the Enterprise crew down to the planet so they can kill them all. Scotty, in charge of the Enterprise, sees through this trick and moves the ship out of range. Meanwhile, Kirk and the landing party escape and start wreaking havoc on the planet by destroying the disintegration chambers. Kirk is eventually apprehended, but when Amon 7 attempts to communicate to the Enterprise to threaten to kill Kirk, Kirk orders Scotty to destroy the planet unless he and the landing party are freed. Spock then arrives after Kirk manages to free himself, and together they destroy the computers responsible for waging the war, leaving the Aminarians in a precarious position as they have officially dissolved their treaty with the enemy planet, thus forcing them into a real war. Ambassador Fox offers to help them negotiate a peace treaty with the other planet to end the war altogether because they are terrified of a real war. The Aminarians agree. So this is a really great episode that's kind of prophetic in that it seems to present an allegory that's even more relevant today than it was when it aired, as the episode warns of the dangers of making war and killing too easy and too clean. Those may become too desensitized to it and thus less invested in ending it. Back in the 60s, they might have been thinking of like atomic bombs or could have correctly predicted where this trend of advanced weaponry would lead. However, in modern day times, it seems even more relevant with technology like drones, which allow people to wage war comfortably from a room halfway around the world, and even remote missiles that can be done comfortably from a safe distance. This episode warns if you don't see the horrors of war, you may become less invested in stopping war at all costs. It reminds me a lot of modern day political slogans that support peace treaties, stating that war is hell and should be a last resort, not a first resort. And Star Trek, in particular, the first 2 seasons of the original series, has always been anti-war and preaching the message that war should be avoided at all costs, with episodes like Errand of Mercy and The Doomsday Machine. However, the anti-war message in this episode is a bit tempered with a side plot about Ambassador Fox trying to avoid a conflict at all costs. In fact, it comes off as incredibly naive and oblivious to the fact that the Minarian's intentions are not peaceful, and he nearly leads the Enterprise into a trap and just barely escapes being killed himself. Whereas Scotty is quoted as saying this:
"Diplomats. The best diplomat I know is a fully activated phaser bank."
And Kirk threatens to kill all of them in order to stop the war. So the good guys are presented as using force and violence over diplomacy, which is quite dubious for an episode that presents an anti-war message. However, the episode ends with Ambassador Fox prevailing and diplomacy winning the day. So possibly sending the message that maybe Might combined with diplomacy can bring peace. But this episode is not only great because it speaks to the dangers of people being desensitized to the horrors of war, but also for being a very exciting and suspenseful episode, as there's constantly a game of cat and mouse being played, as Kirk and Anon 7 trade off being on top and in control, and how Anon tries everything he can to kill the Enterprise crew. It was very nicely played story with a lot of added elements, like Ambassador Fox blundering around and Kirk turning the tables by threatening to destroy the planet. There was also a lot of nice moments in this episode, like this classic scene with Spock.
Sir, there's a multi-legged creature crawling on your shoulder.
That alone makes this episode a classic, but this episode also contains a lot of great montages like this one.
Federation prisoners have attacked their guard and escaped. They are armed. Disintegration station number 12 destroyed, Councilman, apparently by disruptor fire.
All security personnel, Federation prisoners have escaped. They are to be found. They are armed. They resist. Do what is necessary. Planetary disruptor banks. Calculate orbit of star cruiser now circling. Stand by to fire full power.
Councilman, planetary disruptor banks locked onto target. Standing by.
In 10 seconds, open fire. Destroy the star cruiser. Those are the orders of the Council.
And of course, an awesome Kirk speech.
We're human beings with the blood of a million savage years on our hands. But we can stop it. We can admit that we're killers, but we're not going to kill today. That's all it takes, knowing that we're not going to kill today.
But now let me get into some of the faults of this episode. As much as I love it, there are some. For example, Kirk's behavior here is a gross, gross violation of the Prime Directive. I mean, never mind that he goes around destroying the disintegration chambers and eventually destroys the computer responsible for performing a war which is strictly an internal affair of state that has nothing to do with him or the Federation, and by doing so severely interferes in the internal politics of two planets, leaving all of that aside for the moment, he threatens to destroy an entire frickin' planet!
All cities and installations on Eminiar 7 have been located, identified, and fed into our fire control system. In 1 hour and 45 minutes, the entire inhabited surface of your planet will be destroyed. You have that long to surrender your hostages.
I think I remember another Star Trek episode where a Starfleet ship threatened to destroy an entire planet.
Communication status.
No storm damage, sir. All stations report normal. You're ordered to annihilate the Halkins unless they comply. No alternative.
I mean, that's not just a violation of the Prime Directive, that's taking the Prime Directive and wiping his ass with it. This is some evil space alien shit right here. There's no circumstance would be remotely okay to destroy an entire planet. When I first saw this, I tried to rationalize it by saying, oh, Kirk was just bluffing like he did in the Cobra Knight maneuver. But this episode gives absolutely no indication that he was bluffing. In fact, Scotty's reaction to it throughout the episode is that it's actually genuine. So this episode would have us believe Starfleet has a General Order 24.
Scotty, General Order 24, 2 hours. In 2 hours!
Starfleet has an order specifically for the occasion of completely annihilating a planet, and Starfleet isn't evil because... what? I don't know. However, I will admit this plotline did raise the stakes for this particular episode and made it much more exciting and ultimately made me like it even more, just as long as I didn't think too hard about the overall implications. All they needed to do is add in a throwaway line that Kirk was bluffing. That's all they needed to do. Have Scotty say something like, "Ah, good thing we came up with the General Order 24 nonsense. I mean, to think Starfleet would actually have an order to destroy a planet. What are we, barbarians?" That's all they needed to do, and it would have been all good. As for the Prime Directive, it was first introduced in the episode The Return of the Archons, which aired only 2 weeks before this one, so the Prime Directive was hardly an established thing in Star Trek lore at this point, so this episode can be forgiven for not sticking strictly to it, but having Kirk threatening to destroy a planet is unforgivable. Also, this is a minor complaint, but Star Trek, particularly the original series, has a habit of going overboard with the time period of things. For example, in this episode, Anon 7 says their war has been going on for 500 years. 500 years is a long-ass time. I mean, think, 500 years ago from now was 1615. Think of how much has happened in that time period. So I'm sorry, there's no freaking way they've been having a war like this for that long. First of all, it means that they colonized a neighboring planet before 1767, and the war had been going on for at least that long. And all that time, humans went from 18th century technology to flying around the galaxy in spaceships, and these dickheads are still fighting the same pointless war. As I said, this is par for the course for Star Trek, as they often give outrageous time frames for things, and unfortunately this happens in a lot of the Star Trek spinoffs as well, such as Wayun saying the Dominion has been around for 10,000 years. I mean, come on, that's a bit ridiculous to say the least. Although he could have been lying, but still. Anyway, there's no way this war has been going on for 500 years. They'd all be dead by now if it was going on for that long, and there'd be no one left on these miserable planets. But ultimately, they're just minor logistical gripes and doesn't ultimately interfere with my enjoyment of this episode as a fun and exciting allegory for the dangers of being desensitized to the horrors of war. Plus, this is one of the best episodes of Kirk running around the planet kicking ass. The way he faces off with Anon 7 and holds his own was great.
Death, destruction, disease, horror. That's what war is all about, Anon. That's what makes it a thing to be avoided. You've made it neat and painless. So neat and painless, you've had no reason to stop it. And you've had it for 500 years. Since it seems to be the only way I can save my crew and my ship, I'm going to end it for you.
So my rating for A Taste of Armageddon is a 10, the best. In my opinion, a severely underrated episode as it's barely talked about, but it represents everything great about the original series. An allegory for modern times, one that's even more relevant today than it was when it aired, as killing and warfare has become easier and more comfortable and more detached, and explores the dangers in that, and that the horrors of war exist for a reason in order to deter people from waging war in the first place. And of course, Kirk and Spock in classic kick-ass mode as they run rampant over the planet and plays a cat-and-mouse game with the world leader bent on killing everyone on the Enterprise, and he manages not only to save his ship, but to stop a deadly war at the same time. What more could one want from an original series episode? So that's it for my review of A Taste of Armageddon. Be sure to check out my other episode reviews for Star Trek Week. And if there's an episode from any of the 5 Star Trek series you'd like me to review, just leave a comment below with the episode you'd like me to review, but one episode request per person, please. And make sure you subscribe so you can keep up with all that. And thanks a lot for watching.